This is the program from the 1940 convention. This was the second one. The first one was in Tulsa. And the second one was in New York City. The New Yorkers, like Sigmund Spaeth, were interested in bringing this thing to New York City for two reasons. One, there had been this tradition of quartet contests in the parks there going back to the 1920s. Secondly, the World's Fair was in New York City that summer. And so in some sense, it was in conjunction with the World's Fair. This is kind of interesting. It lists the master of ceremonies, Dr. Sigmund Spaeth, author of the book Barbershop Ballads, which was being offered to people as sort of a guidebook. If you wanted to be in a barbershop contest, you didn't quite know what it was, get his book. The welcome committee, the mayor, Fiorello H. LaGuardia, mayor of New York City. And here's another name that's significant, Robert Moses. Now, if you talk to any New Yorker, they know the name of Robert Moses. There's freeways named after him. His name is everywhere. He was he was never mayor of the city, but he kind of chose the mayor. He was kind of a city party boss. And of course, there's books been written about him, an interesting character. Was he a good guy or was he a bad guy? Well, he definitely had an influence, let's put it that way. And whether or not it was corrupt or not, I'll let somebody else decide. But I can say one good thing about him. He loved barbershop harmony, and he always wanted to sponsor barbershop in the parks. And so the finals of this contest was actually held in the open in Central Park. If you're a New Yorker, Central Park down at the southwest corner has something called the Sheep Meadow. The Sheep Meadow actually literally was a sheep meadow back in the very, very early days of the city, and that name just stuck. But it's a big open area, and that's where the finals were set up. And it's right across the park from the zoo. And I've talked to two people who were there who reported that they could sometimes hear the monkeys chattering during the finals. So I guess the singing was annoying the monkeys, or maybe vice versa. Anyway. It's also interesting to look at the judges. Alfred E. Smith, the former governor of New York. He was a presidential candidate, ran against Herbert Hoover. This was the president of the organization, Dempster Godlove. Here's Jeffrey O'Hara. Here's the director of music and the board of education for the city of New York. Here was Edward Smalley. He was a musical arranger, and you see this note was written by Dean Snyder, by the way, former society historian, the late Dean Snyder. And he had written in 1936 a book of 20 close harmony favorites. You notice the use of the word close harmony. And that book was quite popular. In fact, he had a radio program where he would get on the air and demonstrate harmony. This is back before the society, by having a quartet sing and having each part sing an ooh except the featured part. So people could hear how the tenor goes and how the lead goes, how the baritone goes. And, you know, that's something we do now. But he was demonstrating the parts on the radio. And when the society began had its first convention in 1939, he actually announced on his radio program that there was this organization starting and they were having a convention in 1939. And probably a huge contingency came to that first convention because they heard the news on Ed Smalley's radio program. Okay, this is one of the preliminary rounds. It says five preliminary contests, and they were held in different hotels right around the New York, right around Central Park. And so this was one of them. And you can see the name of these quartets. Some of them are funny. This is the, Four Minute a Song, Frog Hollow Four, the Plow City Four. Glenn Howard, who had placed second in the first contest with the Capital City Four, that quartet came to an end. Their bass had a heart attack and died suddenly, very suddenly. So he organized another quartet, Plow City Four. They came back expecting to do great things. Unfortunately, they were 13th. And the top 12 got to sing on Major Bowe's radio program. And when he was telling me about this, you could still see the frustration in his eyes about this contest. I had a fellow, when I joined Barbershop, I attended the old St. Louis number one chapter. And at the time, the director was a man named Jack Owens. He's still living. And he wasn't director very long. He quit, and about a month later, they asked me to be the director. I think I told you that story because I could sight read the music in the just plain Barbershop book. That was my credentials. But Jack said to me, this is fairly recently, and we were at some Barbershop event. He said, you know, I had a brother that sang Barbershop back in the 1940s, and he was the one that got me into it. And he had a quartet, and they actually went to one of the early contests. I said, what was their name? He said, the Chromatic Canaries. And there they are. I said, oh my God, Jack, they're right on, you know, this slide that I show in my history class. I've always wondered who they were because they're from my hometown. So anyhow, this was a preliminary round. As I said, the finals took place, top 10, I believe, or maybe it was top 12, in Central Park, and the judging committee was largely dignitaries. Now, during those finals, one of the quartets overheard Governor Smith lean over and say to Sig Spaeth, who was probably the master of ceremonies at the finals, he said, gee, Sig, he says, I don't know who to give points to. These quartets all sound fine to me. Now, as you can see, some of them had come from quite a distance. So that's not exactly what you want to hear from the judging panel when you're up there competing. So it was after this that the society got a little more serious about judging contests and really started to decide, since people were spending all kinds of money traveling, getting up costumes, working hard to prepare, they said they felt that they need something better than a bunch of non-musicians judging them. So they started thinking about how you should judge a barbershop contest. And it took the first 10 to 12 years of our society's history to figure that out and to finally land on a comprehensive judging system that went into place in 1951. So all this time we were struggling. A different idea every year. We'll talk a little bit more about that. Here were a bunch of the quartets. This is Times Square. You know that intersection, you know, where right there at Times Square, where was it Broadway and is it Fifth Avenue? Broadway and Fifth Avenue meet. You know, Broadway goes crooked, goes catty-cornered down.
They drop the ball every New Year's Eve.
Yeah, right there where they drop the ball. That's where this is. And the quartets, several of them were police quartets. This is the Flatfoot Four. They won. I believe that's the Kansas City Police Quartet, may say there somewhere. But those police quartets would actually be out there directing traffic while they sang. But they had a little ceremony right in the middle of the street. I'm sure the traffic was frustrated. But here they are. They got the picture taken. That's the Flatfoot Four. Somewhere is George McCash. You'll have to read and see where everybody is. O.C. Cash, where's O.C.? I believe that's O.C. right there. Okay? So there they are. And everybody who went to the World's Fair knew that there was a quartet contest going on, so it was great publicity. Here's another thing from that World's Fair. You see it's July 22 to 26. And move back from June to July. And this is kind of fun to read. Talks about the four preliminary contests. If the judges need some time for the decision, a specialty can be introduced by the master of ceremonies or some other barber, or some other surefire performer. Give them a little time. Awards will be made on the spot. Here's kind of the rules, only amateur quartets. Each quartet permitted to sing at least two numbers. Look at that. At least two numbers of their own choice in any competition. One of these may be a medley, but the outside time limit for each number will be 4 minutes. No required numbers, but the general style materials indicated in the Society's official songbook, Barbershop Ballads by Dr. Sigmund Spaeth. So that was offered as sort of the judging manual. Instrumental accompaniment is permitted. First two contests, it was officially permitted. As far as anybody remembered that I talked to, it was never used. Okay, here we go. This was the winners, the Flatfoot Four. They were under the auspices of the police force in Oklahoma City. So it was one of these quartets that represented, you know, an organization or something. That doesn't mean they were professional. They weren't. All right, now this was a great quartet. O.C. Cash indicated several times that he really liked this quartet. He thought they were just great. And I think this lead singer, Britt Stegall, when we were picking out, you know, this committee I'm on for picking out the top 10 or whatever, I keep mentioning the old ones, but of course they never fly because nobody pays any attention to them. But if you listen to this guy's voice, you have to say he was an incredible lead, especially in his day. You knew that was coming. Lay me doon and dee, I would lay me down and die. That's Scottish, yeah. Annie Laurie. So this song, as I said, came to us from Glenn Howard. He had learned it on the street corner, 1919. Somebody taught him the bass part. It's popular in Barbershop because of, same reason as Sweet Adeline's, it's the call and echo. Barbershoppers just gravitate to that sort of thing. And there it is. This was kind of like a polecat song for many, many years. Then, you know, in 1992, I think, I wrote the arrangement that most people know, but it was written as a tribute to Glenn Howard, and the Gas House Gang sang it at International that year. They actually sang it that year better than they did the year that they won. It was really fantastic. And I dedicated the arrangement to Glenn Howard. Now, one unfortunate thing happened is that in the early part of 1992, Glenn passed away. So he didn't get to hear that song on stage. Maybe he heard it up there somewhere, but the arrangement was dedicated to Glenn, from whence this thing came. Now, Joe Stern, a very influential person. I think a lot of what the society came to be was due to Joe Stern. He was a thinker, and he was a philosopher, and he was from Kansas City. He began thinking about this problem of judging. So you see, this letter is in May of 1941. You might say that's rather late to start thinking about how they're going to judge the upcoming contest, but he's offering some points. So you may not be able to read all of this, but he makes 11 points, and I would say those 11 points are pretty fundamental in what eventually happened in terms of our judging categories. He really laid the foundation. First, he says, real barbershop harmony, notice we're still using two words here, contemplates four-part harmony. That is to say, chords with four different notes as far as possible. So what he may be saying is four different notes with possible octave doublings, or he may be saying four different note classes, meaning barbershop goes for the chord that actually has four different notes with no octave doublings, which of course we do. So this is something about close chords are preferable at all times. The low bass, sometimes called church bass, is not conducive to close harmony and should be discouraged. Sometimes the bass takes the note exactly an octave below what he thinks the note ought to be. Now that stuck for a while, but it definitely wasn't in place in the 1940s. Not everybody observed that. The basses really liked to go down that octave back then. But it kind of came to be, you know, that for many, many decades, you know, the 50s and 60s and 70s, there wasn't much low bass. Nowadays, if you got the bass who can sing it, why not? There aren't any rules like that. And again, the close harmony chords are best. Chord with an extremely high tenor, very low bass. These close harmony guys really like to keep it in tight, the chords stacked in tight. Here's a good one. It is permissible, in fact sometimes expedient, to change the lead melody in order to preserve the harmony. Barbershop has always said that we are a style based on harmony. If something in the melody is getting in the way of it, you can probably get away with changing it just to make it work. We do it all the time, have for all time. Basically pitch. If it's too high, the harmony will sound, if it's too low, it sounds muddy. If it's too high, it may cause the singers to show evidence of straining. It says, in judging barbershop contest, while showmanship should be taken into account, I believe that a small ratio of points is sufficient for this. here we go. Here's what I was looking for. No piano or accompaniment is permissible with a barbershop quartet. So he's saying it should be a cappella. And I like the reason he gives. For the reason that a quartet should strive to smooth out the rough spots themselves so that no accompaniment is necessary to cover them up. Besides, the accompaniment detracts from the ability of the quartet. I think what he means by that, it detracts from our ability to tell how good they are. If they're all covered up with accompaniment, how do you know? That accompaniment, he's saying, is a crutch. This is a art form that emphasizes their ability to sing clean chords without instrumentation. Another significant thing about Joe Stern is he was an early person in favor of inclusiveness of the society. He was fighting a losing battle. It was an all-white society. Keep in mind, it was established, our society in Tulsa in the South, segregation was an institution in America. Now you can say, well, every other organization was the same way. That's true. But Stern defended the role and influence of African Americans in the development of barbershop harmony. And he's a Hall of Famer. People tried to say, well, those black people don't sing barbershop anyway. And he said, no, you're wrong. When I grew up in Sedalia, Missouri, he said, I learned barbershop from the African-American harmonizers. In fact, there was an early song that has his name on it as arranger. It's called Daddy Get Your Baby Out of Jail. It's not a song we'd sing nowadays, although they thought it was the epitome of a barbershop song because it talks about, it's basically from a prostitute singing to her pimp. Daddy, get your baby out of jail. Come and get someone to pay my bail. I've been, so mean, took away my cigarettes and my morphine. Buy me just another shot of coke. All night long you'll hear me wail, Daddy, get your baby out of jail. That was one of the most popular songs in the society in the 1940s. They just didn't have, you know, there are many sensitivities we've developed. So that song was there. It had Joe Stern's name on it, but Joe Stern said, I just learned it and many other songs from the people I heard singing in Sedalia, Missouri, and they were African Americans, and I wrote down what I heard. Here is something that happened in 1941. It made headlines that our society was all white. And articles like this one that appeared in the New York Times appeared in major newspapers all across the country. This is something that we did not advertise for many, many years. There was a person who was kind of like the curator at our society headquarters back in the 1980s and 90s. Her name was Ruth Blazina Joyce. I worked with her quite a bit. And she said, for your information, I found a manila folder here that has photocopies of at least 25 articles from major United States newspapers about this issue. Nobody advertised it, but it was huge. And it caused some people to leave the society. Governor Al Smith, for example, didn't want anything to do with it once it was determined that it was all white. And what happened was, that in 1941, the contest was, this is the year after New York City, it was in St. Louis, my hometown. Mayor LaGuardia of New York sent a wire to O.C. Cash saying that the winner of the Parks contest was the Grand Central Red Caps. Red Caps were train porters, so they were singing train porters. And they were four African-American young men, and Cash wired back that you cannot send them, he says, to compete in our contest now, we've made a rule, you have to be a member of our society. To be a member of our society, you have to be white. So there you have it. Sigmund Spaeth did not quit, but he didn't like it. He didn't like it at all. This is the Grand Central Red Caps being stereotypical. The mustaches don't look real. And there they are winning their prize. And there's a story about it. Says the win qualified them as the representative of New York City at the competition held the following week in St. Louis. That tends to indicate that they were going to be allowed to send their winner to the contest until the winner turned out to be a group of African Americans. But they were denied their rightful place by organizers who, in justifying their actions, commented that to keep down any embarrassment, we ought not to permit colored people to participate. In protest, Robert Moses, powerful politician from New York, and former Governor Smith resigned their membership in the society as vice presidents. The racial prejudice is very insidious because nobody's ever guilty of it. It's always, well, I wouldn't mind, but I want to avoid other people being offended. That's always the way. You find very few people that just come out and say, I'm prejudiced. So this was the convention program, my home city, St. Louis, 1941. Dr. Norm Rathert had become a mover and shaker in the society. He was quite a guy. Joe Wodica was also from St. Louis. Here's that guy, Puny Blevins, that was there singing Down Mobile at the very first meeting. They had Alfred Smith listed, because they didn't have time to take his name off after he resigned. O.C. Cash, founder, permanent third assistant, temporary vice chairman. Notice the board of directors has some dignitaries, people that didn't just agreed to have their name listed. Bing Crosby is listed. All right. Bob Hope is listed. Bob Hope actually mentioned this thing on the radio and dedicated a song on the radio to this new organization. As far as I know, that's the only thing he ever did. I don't think Bing Crosby did anything other than his press secretary might have said, sure, go ahead and list my name. Now, this convention is rather interesting, too. You don't see quite so much ridiculous humor in this because it was probably written by Norm Rathert and not by Cash. But you can see the schedule of events. And the finals was held. You see there's elimination, first and second elimination. And the final contest with the St. Louis Municipal Opera House. That later became the Kiel Opera House, and now it's the Peabody in St. Louis. I've actually sung on the stage of that many times. When I joined Barbershopping, we had shows there. And it's also said it was broadcast by KMOX. That's the station that broadcasts the St. Louis Cardinals. I've called there to try to see if there's any transcription of that finals. They claim not, but I don't know if I believe them or not. I think probably buried in some warehouse there might be a transcription of these finals. But you'll never get anybody to help you with it because they don't want to take time for it. This was on the stage of that theater. This is the quartets that were in the finals. This is Norm Rathert. This was the winning quartet. They were the Chordbusters. We'll hear them in a minute. This is the Barflies, who were back. They were now the Phillips 66 Barflies. They competed. I believe that this was Glenn Howard's quartet, and I think this may be Glenn. And they had come back as a reorganized Capital City Four. And their bass was now John Hansen. I introduced you to him. He was the one that sang with Jim Jordan, who became Fibber McGee. Remember that kids quartet I showed you? That was the bass of that was John Hansen. That quartet had John Hansen. I don't know. And the winners? This is the Chordbusters, Oklahoma City, the second winner from Oklahoma City. But you'll see that Illinois took over pretty early. Bass, Tom Massengale, lived until, 15 years ago maybe he passed away, but I have many, many conversations with Tom Massengale. He debunked many myths. One of them was that the old quartets always woodshedded their arrangement. He said that's wrong. He says, most of them sang from written arrangements. He was also a very forward-thinking man. His favorite quartet was the Gas House Gang. And the song he loved the most was Music of the Night. All right? So he was definitely not in the camp of people that thinks Barbershop's going to hell in a hay wagon, because it doesn't sound like it did when I joined. And this quartet had a coach of sorts, or a mentor. His name was Lem Childers. He told me all about this guy. He was a piano player and he was blind. And he taught them harmony by playing things on the keyboard. In fact, he came up with the famous Bye Bye Blues bell chords, and this was the first quartet to sing those because they worked it out with Lem Childers arpeggiating those bell chords on the piano. And there it is written down as they sang it.
Boom, 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 bye. Bye, bye, bye to those blues. Boom, boom, bye. Bye, bye, bye to those blues.
That's pretty neat, huh? I mean, in 1941, this was fancy barbershop and slick arranging. It really, really was. I'm sure people's jaw hit the floor when they heard this. It was really, really good. Of course, we compare it to the Sun Tones, it sounds old-timey, but you got to put it in its time and place. Really was something. The voice of O.C. Cash. This was recorded at a midwinter convention. I'm guessing it was at the midwinter of 1942. And here's what was about to happen. Sigmund Spaeth had said he was going to do a revision, an update, a new edition of his 1925 book, Barbershop Ballad. So indeed, a new version of it came out. I believe it was in 1942 or 1943. Cash knew about this, and he wanted the Flatfoot Four's rendition of Shine to be in that book. And the only thing he could do is record it, and Sigmund Spaeth lifted it off the record. This was made by those homemade record machines. I used to see them when I was a kid. Some people had a machine that would actually cut a record, okay? So somebody was there, had one of those. He made a record, he sent it to Sigmund Spaeth, but he introduced the song by saying, here's their arrangement of Shine. So here we go.
Joseph Cash, and on behalf of the Society for the Preservation and Encouragement, Barbershop Quartet Singing America, Incorporated, I want to present the celebrated Flatfoot Four Quartet of the Police Department, Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Composed of Bert Spiegel, lead, Johnny Whalen, tenor, Red Edith, baritone, Sam Barnes, bass. This record is being made for Dr. Sigmund Spaeth, who is particularly anxious to incorporate in his new book, Barbershop Ballad, the arrangement of Shine. Go ahead, boys.
Love how they just enjoy chords. There you have it. This was the predecessor of the harmonizer. Started being sent out as a mimeographed sheet. This volume one, number one. It was called then the Barbershop Recordings. A couple years later, it became the harmonizer. And you can see that it's just, you know, just a newsletter, okay? Got sent out to all members. On the back page of the recordings was an arrangement. This is an early version of Sweet Roses of Morn. This came from a quartet called the Mound City Four. They were from right across the river from St. Louis. So there are Indian mounds over there. So they call themselves the Mound City Four from Cahokia, Illinois. And this is, you know, a lot like the version that we know, but not quite. So that right off the bat, they started sending out arrangements on the back side of the recordings. This was the Elastic Four. They were our fourth champion, and you see that they are from Chicago. You see the name of Frank Thorne. We recognize that name because there's a Frank Thorne chapter. It's the one you join if you don't want to be in a chapter. And he was the bass. He was also a very strong-willed person and became a leader in the society. From people I know who remember Frank Thorne, they say they make a comparison to Bob Johnson. For people who remember Bob Johnson, it was that authoritative, you didn't want to cross him, you know, he was in charge kind of a guy. And Frank Thorne was also an arranger. He wrote the arrangements for these guys. And even though he was an arranger, he wasn't a terribly good one. He didn't have a good sense of appropriateness. And he wrote really crazy stuff. So anyway, this is it. Oh, and the lead, Roy Frisbee, had an amazing voice. There was another candidate for best, one of the top 10 best leads. So anyway, let's listen to the Elastic Four. You'll enjoy this.
A new moon high sends all its fragrance through the fields I used to roam. When I dream,
here's the fun part.
The moonlight on the then I long for my Indiana home. Indiana home.
How about that? And I should say, Roy is dead now, but I talked to him quite a bit. Roy was a guy you didn't want to talk to unless you had some time on your hands, because he was a talker, but I always enjoyed my conversations with him. He played me recordings of Herman Struble, the tenor, just singing an operatic tenor solo, and the guy was amazing. I mean, he had an amazing voice. There's another picture of the Elastic Four, costumes. This was a score sheet. Says there it was used in 1942 at Chicago. You see that list, you list the quartet name. Every judge is expected to give a score in all these different categories. Harmony accuracy, song arrangement, voice expression, song selection, stage presentation, and these percentages hopefully add up to 100. And so every judge had to give a score in each category. That was the first category judging, as far as I know. Before that, it was just sit there and judge the contest. Grand Rapids category judges was first used. Up to that time, overall evaluating had been the rule, okay? 60 quartets competed in 4 preliminaries with 15 finalists. Emerging the Elastic Four of Chicago were chosen. Interesting. This is the four harmonizers from 1943. Interesting list of them because they were a quartet before there was a society. You know, some of the early champions like the Barflies, Flatfoot Four, had been singing Barbershop before there ever was a Barbershop Harmony Society or SPBSQSA.
This was. Put on your old gray bonnet.
So they all had their own singing style. They weren't all copying anybody.
While I hit Joe Dobbin to the chain.
Woodshedding, apparently.
I want a girl. Just like a girl. That very dear old dad. Oh, look, your father's here. And there's your mother, dear. It's time we had the parlor freshly painted. Time for us to get reacquainted, old Susanna. Boom, boom, boom. Take off that old bandana. Dust off that old piano tonight. Dust that old piano tonight.
What? How about that? Harmony Halls, 1944. Now this group had an entirely different style. Let's listen to this. They were from Grand Rapids. Totally different.
beneath the evening sky. Dear, 'twas then I learned to love you, and our hearts both beat as one. Can you tell me, dear, the reason why? Oh, why? You don't seem like the girl I used to know, I used to know. Your love is not the same as years ago.
So it was very phrased. It wasn't in your face like some of the previous singing. And I remember Glenn Howard telling me he didn't like this quartet because it said it sounded like they were all four singing falsetto. He liked a, you know, quartet, a much more robust quartet sound. But different styles of singing back in the 40s for sure. There's the Harmony Halls again. This is the Misfits, 1945. And again, a quartet that existed before the Society. And it goes back.
I want to go back to my fish and farm. I want to go back to my little ranch at in Kiaka, Hawaii. Where the hooma hooma duka duka up aloha.
So I included the whole thing here just so you could hear that little interlude that they, and the tag. So you notice there's a little bit of development and structure to that thing. It's got, construction. It's a nicely constructed piece, has some variation. So arranging is starting to set in. But interestingly, these guys might have been singing this before the Society existed. So that could be very old. This is Edna Mae Anderson. She went to, with her husband Bill Anderson, not the country singer Bill Anderson, she went to the contest in 1945 and came home. She was one of the women standing over the quarter singing the songs in their own key. The men tagged them Sweet Adelines. She came back determined to start an organization for the women. She did that. And here is the newspaper article that appeared, one of them, in the Daily Oklahoman, and it says, "The Last Blow, Girls Eye Barbershop Quartets." Now, there was this one reporter that had attacked Women's Barbershop with, "Let them liberate their personalities by whipping up hot biscuits and fried chicken." And that really annoyed the women, who all sent them their biscuits because they wanted to prove that they could sing barbershop and cook biscuits. So there's his wife making him eat all the biscuits that the women sent. This was really, the press had a lot of fun with this, as they did when our society started. It was a lot of tongue-in-cheek. But this was especially viewed with great humor because, you know, even though there were women's quartets, they sang on vaudeville, as we have seen, still this was associated with men. And so now, and this was in the early days of Women's Lib. And so, you know, that the last blow. Now they're singing barbershop harmony. What next? So I like this. This is a picture of some of the early ones. Another masculine stronghold falls. And this was the Tulsa number one chapter 2 years later in 1947. And the very first Women's National Convention was held in 1947, won by an Illinois quartet, the Decaturettes from Decatur, Illinois. And let's listen to them, and then we'll take a little bit of a break, a brief
break. Don't you know I love you so? Love you so. Angry, please don't be angry, 'cause I was only teasing you. I wouldn't even let you think of leaving. Don't you know I love you so? Just be. Oh, dearie, please don't be angry.
When I joined Barbershop, every uptune had to have one of those.
Please don't be angry, 'cause I was only teasing.
All right, not bad. Careful harmony. Careful harmony. Yeah, they were really good. I'll let you look at this. This was a Fibber and McGee and Molly. I'm not going to play it because it takes too long, but it's kind of funny. The title of the episode of Fibber, McGee and Molly was called Barbershop Quartet. Fibber wants to sing tenor in a quartet bound for the Cleveland SBEBSQSA convention. So it was kind of advertising for the society. Garden State Quartet, 1946. The interesting thing about this quartet is that they, one piece of lore that I believe Mo Rector told me about them, is that they didn't use a pitch pipe because the lead couldn't get his pitch from it. He didn't know whether, you know, if you blew the key, he couldn't do it. If you blew his first note, he still couldn't do it. So they always just depended. Their song started with a pickup, like, oh, goodbye, my Coney Island. So they always took whatever key he pulled out of his head, and it wasn't very consistent. So they tried to get him to use the pitch pipe. So they were in a performance, and they were all huddled around and blowing the pitch pipe, and you know he would blow it, and he couldn't get it. And he said at some point they just took the pitch pipe, threw it back over their shoulder into the curtain, and took off singing. And that was the last time they ever tried to use the pitch pipe.
Yes.
Like a fashion plate on with the sun's first gleam, sweet, sweet roses of morn.
A little different. The quartets back then liked to end songs on sixths and also on like sevenths, dominant sevenths. They ended a lot of chords and songs on just the seventh chord. And that was just kind of a fad back then. You know, every generation has its fad. This is the Corn Belt Chorus. That's John Hanson, the guy I was telling you about. He directed choruses all over Illinois, and he was one of the ones who started making the chorus a performing unit. Barbershop had been a quartet style up until he decided to put the chorus on stage. He taught all of his little choruses in Illinois the same songs for a show that they brought them all together in Peoria for once a year. He called the combined thing the Corn Belt Chorus, and they put on a show in Peoria, and there's something like 300 guys up there. That's huge. This is the Doctors of Harmony of 1947, Elkhart, Indiana, not too far from Chicago.
No one knows how much I'm longing more and more as these days go. How my heart will break in.
Notice the dynamics, closing off the end, just little musical habits. But very together, very planned, quite different from the early 40s quartets that were just freewheeling. Notice the divorced bass, you know, three high, triad, bass, down. Buzz Hager got into the society about this time. He walked past, he was in, I believe it was San Diego. He was in the military. He walked past and some military men were having a singing barbershop. He just heard the sound outside, walked in, got hooked. This is Frank Thorne's Keep America Singing, and unfortunately you can't read it. I don't know why. He had written a version of Keep America Singing. It wasn't very good. I wish you could see it because it's terrible. Because the society, Phil Embury, who was kind of in charge of, you know, song arrangements, had issued a call for an original song on the theme Keep America Singing so that the society could have a theme song. So Frank Thorne came up with one. Now, another less known fellow named Bill Dikema came up with one too. And I'm sure Phil Embry was between a rock and a hard place, because Bill Dikema's was a nice, simple song. Everybody could sing it, and it was good. It sounded like a legitimate song. But Frank Thorne was a big, powerful guy, and he's not a guy you want to get on his bad side. So I can imagine Phil Embry sweating bullets over this. But Bill Dikema showed up at International, and in the lobby of the hotel, he distributed copies of his to everybody that was there. And he had his chorus there, and they stood up on this grand stairwell. He assembled his chorus, and they sang it, and then got everybody in the lobby to sing along with him. And everybody took that thing home, and there was, you know, it was chosen by popular demand. So Phil Embry was off the hook, and that became Keep America Singing, Now Keep the Whole World Singing. Rules Change, 1948. This is Molly Regan. I could tell you more about him. He was one of the early arrangers. He came up with a clock system. You know, we have the circle of fifths, and it's got 12 positions like a clock. You know, if you're in key of C, C, G, D, blah, 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 you go around fifths. But you can also label those positions by 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock. So the old arrangers talked about the 1 o'clock chord. That was just the dominant chord, right? And 2 o'clock chord was what we call Roman numeral 2. Pittsburghers, 1948. Tommy Palamone passed away. Cool guy. He was another one of these guys, if you didn't want to talk to him unless you had some time. He was a talker. But what a cool guy. And I had a number of conversations with him. Now, Molly Regan probably arranged this. This is a classical pattern. This was sung for years.
A cozy place to dream our dreams, to live in love and our scheming schemes, a paradise just made for nobody else would be there, just a place to build and prove my only wish is
a miss.
To taste your sweet kisses, give me a night in June.
First key change we've heard that's a key lift, right? That came around with arrangers.
With you, just give me a bright and silvery night in June with you.
Yeah, and that was sung for many years. In fact, it was cool if you knew all of the patter words to that. But when I started going to Harmony College, I had to learn those just because, you know, you're really cool if you could sing the patter to Give Me a Night in June. I should say that the year the Pittsburghers won, the Mid-States Four were there, and they were a very popular quartet, had a lot of flair. A lot of people thought the Mid-States Four should have won. And in fact, the same recording somebody was talking about O.C. Cash's voice being interviewed, was at that convention. And when they, and it actually has the call off, when they call the Mid-States for second, you can hear some negative reaction in the crowd. Oh no, you know. So, you know, as I said before, nowadays everybody always agrees with the judges, so we don't have problems like that. Johnson Sisters. This was in 19, I don't play all of the women's champions, there's not enough time, but this is really significant. Now I show this slide, and this is a Mars and Venus thing. I did this, made a presentation for Sweet Adelines, but I had mostly a room full of women. And I showed this slide, and the women were all aghast. And I said, "What's the matter?" And they said, "The shoes don't match." I had never noticed it. Anyway, they don't.
Take your baby.
This may be a woodshed arrangement.
Oh, Lordy, Lordy, that band. See those soldiers.
Carefully woodshed and carefully worked out by you.
They
were from Chicago, and they, there's four little girls that grew up singing together. Mother taught them harmony.
Watch them going through the grill. I just can't make my pee-pee still for when I hear.
there's something about it that is grand. And although I never felt this way before,
there's
I
want
to do a two-step right to war when I hear that great, great, great regiment band.
There you have it. Mid-States 4, now a Society Hall of Fame quartet as of 2010. This is the first, chronologically, the first quartet to be listed in the Hall of Fame. I don't mean, let me say that. They're the earliest champion to be in the Hall of Fame. They didn't get inducted first. The Suntones were the first. anyway, let's listen. This is a classic ballad for years. Now, this is about a child that has died. It's called Fingerprints. She sees the kid's fingerprints on the window. Really sad.
Oh, the teardrops were silently falling. Foolish tears that I knew.
That song could work, or is it too much? Most people remember the Mid-States Four from their comedic performances. They used instruments. They were very vaudevillian, and when they performed on shows, they picked up the instruments, string, bass, and guitar, and sang.
Good old days, good old days, ring them back.
Sort of a precursor to the Buffalo Bills, you know, with banjo. This is a song Barbershoppers sang for years and years. Haven't heard it much lately.
Hats and derby and spats. Do you remember?
What's that? Really?
Do you remember the Dixieland jazz? The Bodioco and Razzmatazz. You broke your back up all in the jack. Do you remember when?
There's a picture of the Mid-States Four and a subsequent harmonizer. Judy Garland, the good old summertime. I won't even tell you what happens here. It is.
In the evening by the moonlight, you should drop, you folks should drop down to.
Remember this song?
A fellow by the name of Bill Jefferson Law.
He began to whine, he'd sing a song. He just sang and played the whole night long.
Till one night a starry-eyed lady, they called Lovable Sadie, heard him playing that barbershop chord.
When he finished, Sadie drew a sigh.
Oh, Lord.
Every time that she would catch his eye, she'd
Mr. Jefferson Law, play the barbershop chord, that soothing harmony, it makes an awful, awful, awful hit with me. Play
I love that harmonization right there.
Just to please me again, cause mister, when you start that minor part, heaven and a grip in my heart. Oh, Lord.
Oh, Mr. Lord,
play the barbershop chord.
Mr. Jefferson, Lord.
Thomas Jefferson, Lord.
Play that barbershop chord.
Play the barbershop chord.
That soothing harmony.
Sweet harmony makes a terrible, terrible, terrible. That minor part, I feel your fingers slipping and a grip in my heart.
Oh, Lord,
Mr. Jefferson, Lord, play that barbershop chord.
When I saw that, I just had to be in the class. I'm sorry. Thanks for that indulgence there. This is funny. So by 1950, there had lots of things that happened. You know, they were developing these new judging categories. And all of this seemed very incongruous to people that had been barbershopping for less than 10 years, or maybe that remembered barbershop before the society, and remembered barbershop as just a, you know, a freewheeling, spontaneous thing you did, and now there were all these rules and things. So one of the society's historians, F. Sterling Wilson, who was also a very popular MC, wrote this goofy thing, and it was goofy enough that I've incorporated. It has some funny things in it. Let me read a couple of paragraphs here. The greatest simplification of the rules, he's talking about the rules, all the rules. The greatest simplification of the rules is the reduction in points to be earned from 3,000 to 2,978, which makes it possible for a judge to apply Einstein's short equation as follows. X times F squared equals MNQ minus KLZ. Where X equals the number of judges, M equals the population of the city where the contest is held, and Y equals Bill Dikema. The remaining symbols cannot, of course, be revealed until the winner is announced, but I assure you it has nothing to do with the Marshall Plan. Okay, I like this one. As an incentive to quartets to develop even more poisonous harmonies, credits are given for new arrangements, but to curb irresponsible persons. It has been ruled that if an old song is sung with a new arrangement, or a new song with an old arrangement, or an old song with an old arrangement, or a new song with a new arrangement, or any combination thereof, and the quartet singing it sings it better or worse or the same as it has been sung by any quartet in a bona fide contest held east of the Monongahela River or west of a line drawn between Old Orchard Beach, Maine, and Key West, Florida, omitting, of course, post office sites and National Guard armories, the judges are entitled to shoot the tenor. This rule has been considered somewhat drastic, and a compromise is being worked out whereby the judges will shoot only baritones, leaving everyone satisfied except possibly the baritones, and even then their families will benefit under Article 5, Paragraph 18. So there you have it. All kinds of stuff there. Let's go on. Buffalo Bills. This was a landmark and a turning point, and it's a good place for us to culminate this class, but we'll spend a few minutes here on the Buffalo Bills with your indulgence. So this was the original version. As you know, they went to Broadway, sang in The Music Man. We'll talk about that. We're actually going to advance the clock and get out of our era for a minute. Their original baritone, Dick Grapes, did not go with them, but he won with them. He actually was estranged from the society for many years, but in the 1990s, he came back, actually emceed a contest in Kansas City, and kind of reconciled himself with the society. Anyway, this is the Buffalo Bills from when they won.
Floating down, my honey, floating medley. Down. Floating down the river, down to Cotton Town. Just hear that whistle, tootin' away. And those darkies singing, banjos ring till break of day. Goodbye, old Dixie, goodbye. I've got a tear in my eye. Though I ramble away now and then, you can gamble I'm coming back again nightly while I am away. This is the prayer that I'll say. Oh, hear me while I am napping, Lord.
anything should happen, maybe in Dixie too. Die. Goodbye, Dixie, goodbye, goodbye.
So we kind of missed that last chord in the swipe nowadays because we've heard it the other way. Yeah, they got off the sixth chord. If you looked at that list of rules that Molly Regan wrote down, he said he was complaining about the fact that the quartets were ending on something other than the tonic chord. He said Barbershop should end on the tonic chord. So they went to Broadway. This is from The Music Man.
Just a minute, Professor Hills. Sorry, Professor, but we're the school board, and we need your credentials.
Academic certificates?
Nothing of the kind.
We need letters and papers.
Make him put up a bond.
What am I hearing? You, sir.
Say ice cream. Well, ice cream, but I don't sing, if that's what you mean.
Talk, then.
Down here, ice cream. Ice cream. Talk slow. Ice cream.
You see? Singing is just
sustained talking.
Now you, sir.
Ice cream.
Now you, sir.
Ice cream.
Now you, sir.
Ice cream.
Ladies, from now on, you'll never see one of those men without the other three.
Professor, you're wrong. Why, they've hated each other for 15 years.
Ice cream, ice cream, ice cream.
You go ahead, Mom. I'll be there in a minute.
How can there be any sin in sincere? Where is the good in good? Fine in good. Bye. Your apprehensions
confuse me, dear.
Puzzle and mystify, tell me what can be fair in farewell.
This is Scotty Ward. He was their replacement baritone.
While one single star shines above. Can there be any sin? Aren't we sincerely in love? All in
I just want to say thank you all for being here. I hope this was helpful to you. My goal is to give you something to, you know, orient yourself in Barbershop with. And I really appreciate all the contributions that you've made this week and insightful comments and questions. And I hope you enjoy the rest of your week here at Harmony College. Thanks for coming to History Hour.